Diarrhea, diarrhea. Men have named you. Well, the diarrhea is going to be divided up into two different parts here. They're going to be infectious diarrheas in the other section, and here antibiotic-associated diarrhea, malabsorption diarrhea, microscopic colitis diarrhea. Small bowel, short bowel, diarrheas. Antibiotic-associated diarrhea, super important subject, and that is, for such a long period of time, we said that the best initial therapy was metronidazole. Metronidazole it was for 30 years for Clostridium difficile-associated diarrhea. Clostridium difficile-associated diarrhea. What a great name. Do you see Dad? Yes, I see Dad. Clostridium difficile-associated diarrhea. And so for C. diff associated diarrhea, although there can be white cells and red cells, as they're all in all invasive diarrheas, the stool toxin test is very good. But the problem with the stool toxin test is that it's not positive in everybody. The single most sensitive test for Clostridium difficile associated diarrhea is the PCR. Second, when the flagyl metronidazole is in the answer, you're going to say vancomycin as the best initial therapy. So any antibiotic can cause Clostridium difficile associated diarrhea. Now, clindamycin may do it the most, but any of them can do it. And so therefore, it can be of any history. Even ones like amoxicillin, as simple an antibiotic as that, can cause C. diff. So the best initial test is a toxin, and if you see the toxin, well, it depends whether there's diarrhea, because one of the questions you could be getting is, says an asymptomatic person on screening has a C. diff toxin in their stool. That doesn't mean that you have to treat it. It does mean, however, the person needs to be on isolation, contact, not airborne. Can't airborne and aerosolize your poop, but the toxin doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be treated unless you have diarrhea that goes with it. White cells in the stool is a feature of invasive diarrheas. Salmonella, Shigella, Yersinia, Campylobacter have invasion and white cells in them. Now, the other thing about the C. diff is that although toxin in the face of diarrhea means you have C. diff with diarrhea and toxin, and you go straight to therapy, the problem with the C. diff toxin is it can be negative in 20 and 30% of patients, and that's why PCR becomes the overall single most accurate test. It becomes like herpes encephalitis. PCR is like an antigen. HIV, PCR is like an antigen. Hepatitis C, HIV, C. diff, it's actual bug. So if you treat people, does the PCR go away? It does, because it's the actual bug. It's actual viral particles or bacterial particles that will tell you that the organism's actually replicating. The toxin does not tell you you have organism replicating now, because toxin can be found in 1 or 2% of the general population. Diarrhea with toxin? Vancomycin. PCR with diarrhea? Vancomycin. Metronidazole will be in the choices, and vancomycin simply has greater efficacy. IV vancomycin or oral vancomycin? Oral vancomycin, because IV vancomycin will not penetrate the bowel. Oral vancomycin is not absorbed and won't go systemically. IV vancomycin won't penetrate the wall and won't go into the bowel. Now, that was a difference from metronidazole, because metronidazole IV would go into the bowel. So there is a place for it. It is for people who are either not responding or failing or unable to get vancomycin. And then if you had a person, metronidazole can cover some of them, but not as much as vanco and not as much as fidaxomicin. Very expensive, but the issue is efficacy. And what we have is that fidaxomicin is both the alternative to vanco for acute therapy and also prevents recurrences. So what do you do next for this? There's also bezlotoxomab. Oh my goodness, what a long word. Bezlotoxomab? Bezlotoxomab is a monoclonal antibody that stops recurrences. You have an antibody to C. diff toxin? Bezlotoxomab. IV vancomycin for Clostridium difficile colitis. IV vancomycin, I use it every day. but not for things that are inside your bowel. IV won't penetrate the bowel wall to go in for diarrhea, and oral won't penetrate the bowel wall to come in for systemic infections. So you switch to fidaxomicin if there's no response to vancomycin. What is the place of metronidazole? Third line. Third line because it has less efficacy, or in combination for very severe disease, in combination with the other drugs. So we don't realize that in some people exactly how horrible C. diff can be. There are some people that it actually shuts down their bowel function, causes a toxic megacolon, and can actually kill you. And sometimes we actually have to cut people's bowel out. Okay, so let's define severe. What does it mean? It's not the number of bowel movements. It's not the number of bowel movements. You can have terrible bowel movements. You can have 10 bowel movements a day. It doesn't mean you're going to die. It means your systemic, your serum, your blood white count, systemic infection. It means that you have metabolic acidosis from your infection because it's systemic infection. High lactate because it becomes systemic infection. So fulminant colitis is when it's not really colitis anymore, right? Because if it goes into your body and it causes you to have a high systemic white count and a metabolic acidosis and lactate, decreased perfusion and not perfusing your kidneys, then it's not really colitis. It's colitis that's now ripped into your bloodstream and you do a colectomy. Malabsorptions. Malabsorptions. Well, we have celiac disease, sometimes known as gluten-sensitive enteropathy. That is an IgA attacking your bowel wall with the antigen to gluten. And gluten is a $5 word for wheat. You remember a hapten mechanism? Hapten, like half a protein. You have like an antibody that's made partly to penicillin and partly to your red cell. You have partly to quinidine and partly to a red cell, and you needed both of those things to provoke the antibody against your red cell. Well, celiac disease is like a hapten in a way. You need the wheat antigen, gluten antigen, and then it attacks your bowel. Your whole small bowel rips it. Everything from your duodenum all the way to your ileocecal valve. So that's why you have to remember your step one absorption of GI physiology that says, well, I'm gonna malabsorb everything that's in the duodenum, divalent cations, calcium, magnesium, iron, all the way down to my ileocecal valve. Now, chronic pancreatitis means dead pancreas. So this can be confusing for some students that mistake it with just severe pancreatitis. Chronic pancreatitis has a normal amylase and lipase, or even low, because you've killed off the pancreas and there's no amylase and lipase left in it. So chronic pancreatitis is the same thing as saying a dead, non-functional pancreas. Now, it can't be all the way dead, because if your pancreas was all the way dead, you would have no insulin and you would be dead. So it's just mostly dead. It means burnt out, running on life support pancreas. But it also means no bicarbonate, but no amylase and no lipase. So the big thing about chronic pancreatitis, fat malabsorption. Now, the other two, Whipple's disease, an infection, and tropical sprue, an infection. And the word tropical sprue is a very good name because it means you've been to the tropics and you picked up a bug. And the other good name thing about it is that you diagnose it with a biopsy, seeing the bugs, and you treat it with antibiotics because it's a bug thing. Whipple's disease too is a systemic inflammatory autoimmune reaction to Trophorema whippellii, which is an infection. But again, both, since they're bacterial infections, can be treated with antibiotics, which these cannot. So tropical sprue, I'm in the tropics, I've got a bug in my bowel. Why do these go together? Because they're all fat malabsorptions. Chronic pancreatitis because you don't have lipase, and the others because your bowel wall, the small bowel, is destroyed. What nutrient, fat, carbohydrates, or proteins, is normally absorbed in the colon? Nothing. The colon is a watery absorber. What goes into the colon is the consistency of sort of loose stool, mostly a water with some brown stuff in it. But by the time it gets to the ileocecal valve, there should be no nutrients in there. So these things are malabsorption in the small bowel. So which of them gives steatorrhea, which is fatorrhea? And the answer is all of them give steatorrhea because they're all small bowel destructions or loss of lipase. Which of them gives visual disturbance? All of them, because they all malabsorb fat. And if you malabsorb fat, you malabsorb vitamin A. Which of them gives bone problems? Well, they all malabsorb fat. They all malabsorb fat. Since they malabsorb fat, they malabsorb vitamin D. And if they malabsorb vitamin D, they get bone problems. You get my drift here? Which of them gives weight loss? All of them, because they all malabsorb fat. Which of them gives you bleeding? All of them, because they all malabsorb fat. Celiac, tropical sprue, and Whipple's disease, because they've destroyed the small bowel and they can't absorb fat. Because you're not absorbing fat in the colon, ladies and gentlemen. Because what nutrient is absorbed in the colon? Yeah, I'm doing it like this on purpose so that you will get this so repetitively in your brain that you'll hear my voice in your head in test day that says, which of them gives you bleeding? All of them, because they all malabsorb fat. And if they malabsorb fat, they malabsorb vitamin K, and they all get bleeding. Which malabsorbs B12? All of them, because you need an intact ileocecal valve, an intact terminal ileum to absorb B12. But one of the things that a lot of students don't know is that you need pancreatic enzymes. And if you got a dead pancreas, chronic pancreatitis, dead pancreas, amylase and lipase, normal or low, you can't absorb B12. You need pancreatic enzymes to absorb B12. Not just you, but me too. You see, when B12 comes into the body, it's put onto R protein in the saliva to survive the acid of the stomach. And then the pancreatic enzymes take the B12 off the R protein so it can be attached to intrinsic factor so it can be absorbed in the terminal ileum. Or for the international graduates, R protein is a J or an H visa, intrinsic factor is a green card, and citizenship is in the terminal ileum. So chronic pancreatitis makes you malabsorb B12 because if you don't have pancreatic enzymes, you can't absorb B12. They all give steatorrhea. They all give oily, greasy, floating, flying stool, frothy, foul-smelling. Foul-smelling? How's your normal smell? How does your stool smell? Oh, mine smells like flowers. How's yours? Foul! Well, it's not just foul because of fat. It's because the fat goes into your bowel, and since in your colon it's not absorbed, that fat goes into your colon and ferments, and you get a fermented fatty stool, sort of like a stool-flavored yogurt fermenting in your butt. Yeah. They all give steatorrhea. Which one gives a positive Sudan black? Sudan black is the fat stain of stool. So they all do. They all give floating, flying, frothy stools. They all give weight loss. They all give a positive B12, a loss of B12. They all give a positive Sudan black. They all cause bleeding and bone and eye because they all cause malabsorption of vitamin A. They all cause malabsorption of vitamin D. They all cause malabsorption of vitamin K. They all. What? Which one gives iron deficiency? Not chronic pancreatitis. Celiac disease, mostly. Not all. So you see, you don't need pancreatic enzymes. And that's how you're going to tell them apart. You don't need pancreatic enzymes to absorb iron. And that is how you will tell these apart. Now, celiac disease is really common. Tropical sprue and Whipple's are profoundly rare. So at most places, it's going to come down to celiac, gluten-sensitive enteropathy versus chronic pancreatitis. And the clue for you is going to be the iron malabsorption. Celiac will distinguish it because you need to have pancreatic enzymes to absorb all the others, but not for iron. So celiac disease actually quite commonly presents with iron deficiency anemia. So clinically, what distinguishes tropical sprue from celiac disease? The answer is nothing. They present the same. It's not until you get a bowel biopsy actually you can tell the difference. Now, this thing about celiac disease with dermatitis herpetiformis, it's not going to help because it's not there most of the time. It's a great name. It's dermatitis that is in the form of herpes. Dermatitis herpetiform is, because it is a dermatitis that is in the form of herpes. It's not there most of the time. Steatorrhea happens with all of them, fat malabsorption. But when you have steatorrhea, ooh, arthralgias. I didn't say arthralgias. Joint pain? We didn't say that with any of the others. Ocular findings. Neurological findings. Ooh, now that's different. Steatorrhea. Now, steatorrhea means malabsorption of vitamin A, D, E, and K. Steatorrhea means weight loss. Steatorrhea means positive Sudan black, which is the fat stain. That all of this, that's how you know it's Whipple's disease. Whipple's disease, Trophorema whipplei. Now, the most accurate test for celiac, bowel wall biopsy, Whipple's bowel wall biopsy, and tropical sprue, bowel wall biopsy, is the most accurate test. In these, you're actually looking for a bug, and that's why you treat them with antibiotics, ceftriaxone, Bactrim, which is trimethoprim sulfate, doxycycline. And the best initial test for celiac is see there's a blood test. On Whipple's disease, it's not a blood test. You do PCR of the bowel biopsy. PCR is more accurate. They're PAS staining organism, but more accurate than PAS staining organism is PCR, which could either be done in the bowel wall biopsy or, in fact, in the stool itself. So, for celiac disease, although the most accurate test, the bowel wall biopsy, there are blood tests. So, in the past, we used to do these functional tests. Hey, take this D-xylose and drink D-xylose. Now, xylose is a 5-carbon sugar. Xylose should not need any digestion. Did not need any digestion, just absorption. And if your bowel wall is intact, D-xylose should end up in the urine. Celiac disease, it wouldn't end up in the urine because your bowel wall is not intact. Now, we use blood tests. Blood tests, the same way for B12 deficiency, Schilling's test, whatever. We do methylmalonic acid, anti-intrinsic factor, antiparietal cell antibodies instead of the Schilling's test. Here, tissue transglutaminase, endomysium. You know what the endomysium is? The bowel wall. $5 word for bowel wall. Anti-gliadin. Gliadin is anti-wheat, anti-bowel wall. Anti-wheat, anti-bowel wall antibodies in the blood. And the most accurate is a bowel wall biopsy with flattened villi, and Whipple's a bowel wall biopsy too, to see the organisms, or PCR, both the bowel wall biopsy, as well as in the stool. You can see the organisms in the stool with Whipple's disease. Tropical spool through, the organisms are on the bowel wall biopsy to allow you to note who gets antibiotics. But here's the thing about celiac disease. Even if you know, and you're like, look, dude, I got it. Steatorrhea, they all cause vitamin A, D, E, K, they all cause weight loss, they all cause the eye and bone problems. You just told me that they get B12 malabsorption, and you told me that celiac has iron, that's how you tell it apart, because the others, okay, that chronic pancreatitis, you don't need pancreatic enzymes to absorb iron, your tissue transglutaminase is positive, your endomysial is positive, your gliadin is positive. Yo, dude, it's celiac. I got it. It's celiac. So why do I need to do a bowel wall biopsy? And the answer is you have to do the bowel wall biopsy anyway because you're supposed to be smart and knowledgeable enough to know that even if you've diagnosed the celiac disease, you haven't excluded the fact that those abnormal lymphocytes can become cancerous. And that's your question. Chronic pancreatitis has other tests for it, abdominal calcifications, which on x-ray are there about half the time. But you can kind of understand, 50 years ago we had x-rays, 100 years ago we have x-rays. Willem Conrad Röntgen, described x-rays in the 1890s. So where it's long, right? So we could do abdominal x-rays 125 years ago. And they were not that great then, but it's the tool we had. Abdominal CT, quite good. So you know my next question. What's the most accurate? What's the most accurate? And the most accurate in this case is a functional test. Because just knowing that you have malabsorption of fat is not specific enough. How do we stimulate the pancreas to see if it works? Because this is not an antibody. It's not that you're allergic to your pancreas. It's chronic pancreatitis is that you've had repeated episodes of alcoholism and stones, and your pancreas is simply burnt out. The secretin stimulation test. Now, I didn't say we do it much, but the secretin stimulation is the most accurate. Now, this is different than the secretin test we said with Zollinger-Allison. In Zollinger-Allison, it wasn't a stimulation test, it was a suppression test. In Zollinger-Allison, we said, I'm gonna give you IV secretin, because it's a hormone. Hormones mean into the blood. So in Zollinger-Allison, we gave you IV secretin, and we look for suppression, which is normal. Because in all suppression tests, the normal is suppression. And a failure of suppression was an abnormal test, positive test, abnormal test. But here, I give IV secretin and I put a nasogastric tube into your bowel, there a normal should be a big release of bicarbonate. And the juiciest organ in your body is actually the pancreas. That gland is 75 grams, very tiny, basically 2 or 3 or 4 ounces, 2 or 3 or 4 ounces, and that gland should be able to secrete 2-3 liters a day of fluid. Wow. So here's the calcifications on an x-ray, very far advanced, but if they're there, they're specific. Here's the calcifications on a CT scan. Well, very far advanced, but if they're there with the proper symptoms, steatorrhea and fat malabsorption, they're specific. A pseudocyst is because the injury to your pancreas weeps fluid, like a blister, weeps fluid. And the pancreas sort of walls it off, but it's not really a wall. It's just that it's covered around, and the pancreas, which is a sort of a soft, mushy organ, just sort of goes around it. So it's not really a wall, and that's why it's called the pseudocyst, because it may surround it, but it's not the same thing as really having a wall. But remember, the most accurate test, IV secretin, NG tube or tube into your small bowel, looking for a big release of bicarbonate into your small bowel. Chronic pancreatitis can be treated with over-the-counter enzyme replacement. You can get enzyme replacement anywhere because it's not considered a drug. Getting amylase, lipase, and trypsin is considered a dietary supplement. You can go get it right now. What would giving the enzyme replacement do for a normal person? Not much. What would happen is that since the enzymes, the trypsin, chymotrypsin, amylase, and lipase, enzymes are proteins. So what would happen is your bowel would simply absorb it like it was another protein, because 40% of the protein in the human diet is you. You sauce. You take your own enzymes, and after they've absorbed all your food, they turn around and they get absorbed themselves. Celiac disease is managed by avoiding gluten-sensitive gluten. Hey doc, it hurts when I do that. Don't do that. Wheat, rye, oats, barley. Okay, let's do this one. Safe, not safe. Safe, not safe. Rice. Safe, not safe. Safe, not a gluten. Okay, that's too easy. You know where these things fail? It'll be described like this. A person comes in, they've been diagnosed with celiac disease. They had weight loss and steatorrhea. They had malabsorption of the fat-soluble vitamins, B12, and iron deficiency. And where people fail is it says, I've had my diet, and I'm still having diarrhea. So where they fail is at the alcohols. Beer, safe, not safe. Not safe, because beer is a wheat derivative. And gluten-free beer, one of our co-authors had celiac disease. She's like, I'd rather have the diarrhea. So beer, not safe. Now, whiskey, safe, not safe. Not safe, because whiskey is a wheat derivative. Vodka, safe, not safe. Not safe, because unless specifically labeled, whiskeys, beer, and especially vodka are wheat derivatives, unless it's labeled as such. So they fail at the alcohols. Vodka, whiskey, beer, no bueno. Nea cha. Whipple's disease, you treat with antibiotics because it is an organism, and the same with tropical sprue. You could say doxycycline or tetracycline. The tetracycline class is what we really mean. So rice and wine are safe because they're not wheat derivatives. Now, how do you distinguish pancreatitis from bowel wall abnormality? What we mean by this is, how do you tell the difference between an enzymatic deficiency from the pancreas or that you've got a villous bowel wall lining defect? Well, one is the things we've said, which is the secretin stimulation. But secretin stimulation is sort of a pain in the ass. IV secretin is hard to get. Second, you have to put a nasogastric tube in. Next, you'd have to do a bowel wall biopsy. Yep. But functionally, the other test is the D-xylose. D-xylose test is normal when you have chronic pancreatitis because you don't need digestive enzymes to absorb Z-xylose. It's a tagged 5-carbon sugar that, if your bowel wall is intact, should go right into your urine. Carcinoid syndrome has a malabsorption, but what's different about it? What's different about it is it causes cardiac problems. All of the serotonin and serotonin derivatives. Turns out your heart does not like to be cooked with all these serotonin-type derivatives. 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid as the breakdown product of it cooks the right side of your heart. Also, the other thing is that by definition, the diarrhea goes along with flushing and wheezing because this is a vasoactive substance, the carcinoids, that gets made. And your body does not like the serotonin. Your blood vessels don't like the serotonin. And what happens is that the carcinoid, by definition, is metastatic when you have symptoms. Now, an exception is the 2% that are bronchial carcinoids. Carcinoid means that you have a bowel lesion that has generally metastasized to your liver, and your liver has become packed with carcinoid, and your liver has become overwhelmed because normally what happens is that when these transmitters get made out of the bowel wall, the liver metabolizes them. So when the liver becomes packed with mets, it can't metabolize them, so the right side of your heart gets bathed in these transmitters, which causes tricuspid insufficiency and pulmonic stenosis because it fries them, cooks them. Chicharrones de su corazones. It fries your heart. It means cardiac shawarma, cardiac pakoras. The best initial test is to look for the breakdown product in the urine, urinary 5-HIAA, and you treat it because octreotide somatostatin. Same octreotide that we use for varices, yep. The same octreotide that we can use occasionally to control prolactin, prolactinomas, yes, although we use dopamine agonists first. The same octreotide as somatostatin that is occasionally used to control acromegaly. Because remember, somatostatin never met a hormone it didn't like to inhibit, and there's no adverse effects of octreotide. So we use this to control the diarrhea. Now, these lactose intolerance, what's different about this from all the other forms of diarrhea? Number one, there's no fat malabsorption, so there's no steatorrhea. Ooh, but hard to tell apart, right? Because lactose intolerance doesn't cause weight loss because you're not malabsorbing. It doesn't cause weight loss because you're not malabsorbing fat, but it's still, you're not malabsorbing the fat-soluble vitamins. So you have two smelly people and you're like, yeah, but the fat malabsorption is like really smelly. Well, I don't know. I don't really want to go like on stool smell history. So the weight loss and the other thing about lactose intolerance about it is no blood. But well, carcinoid doesn't give blood. Celiac doesn't give blood. Whipple's didn't give blood. Tropical sprue didn't give blood. None of them gave blood. The only one that gives blood is inflammatory bowel. So most of the time, you just take the milk out of people's diet and watch for resolution. But there is a test. And if you drink milk, you drink lactose, your stool osmolality goes up. Stool osmolality, yeah, you can measure stool osmolality as a specific test. Yogurt's okay because the bacteria and the microorganisms have already eaten the lactose for you. So you're eating pre-digested from bacteria that have already eaten the sugar in your yogurt. I think that this is not hard at all for most people because people around people or you yourself have lactose intolerance. Isn't that true? Strength and honor, Maximus Flatus. And oral lactase replacement, because lactase, you just replace the brush border enzyme. What happens to the lactase if you took it in a normal person? The same thing as if you took amylase. You get the pattern here? Amylase, trypsin, chymotrypsin, lactase are all digestive supplements. They're all food supplements, so you don't need a prescription for a food supplement. Irritable bowel syndrome. Now, what is the single most common symptom of irritable bowel? Not diarrhea. What's the single most common symptom? Not diarrhea less than night, but it does have diarrhea. It does have diarrhea less than night. That's true. It's not the most common. What is the most common symptom? Constipation. Yes, that's true, but it's not the most common. Constipation, that's a yeah. Diarrhea alternated with constipation. That's true, but it's not the most common. The most common symptom in irritable bowel syndrome is pain. Irritable bowel syndrome is a pain syndrome. It's a pain syndrome. It's pain with diarrhea. It's pain with constipation. It's pain with diarrhea alternated with constipation. It's pain that's less at night. It's pain with diarrhea or constipation, diarrhea alternating with constipation, and all the symptoms that's less at night. It's pain. Irritable bowel syndrome is a pain syndrome that also has diarrhea or constipation or both. It's a pain syndrome that doesn't have a test. It's a pain syndrome that has negative tests, and that's the point. Negative abdominal CT, negative upper endoscopy, lower endoscopy, all tests are negative and you have a pain. Now, we think that irritable bowel syndrome may be from excess contractions of the bowel. What we know is that the stomach contracts, how often we say? Stomach has pacemaker cells, contracts about 3 times a minute. The duodenum contracts 6, 8, 10 times a minute. The small bowel contracts 6, 8 times a minute. And what happens in irritable bowel is we think it's sort of like SVT or AFib. Your bowel tissue is contracting more frequently than it should and going nee, 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 and you get pain. There's a lot. It's a big muscular tube, right? Irritable bowel, the bowel is a muscular tube with an epithelial coating and a stool filling. It's a long muscular stool burrito. Pain relief by bowel movement. These are the so-called Rome criteria, and basically that's how you're going to make the diagnosis. And that's how it's going to be. No blood, no weight loss, no fever, and pain relieved by bowel movement. Pain with it relieved by a change in bowel habit. So the other characteristic is that there's nothing on your stool, and there's nothing on any of the tests either. So you treat it if it's like the nee, 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 nee. So we go, let's put some fiber in your diet. Instead of your bowel going nee, 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 now you got all this fiber and go, because we bolted up with all the fiber. Oh, you see, I said that in irritable bowel, is that the bowel's contracting too much, so we give things that relax it, hyoscyamine, a little relax your smooth muscle in your bowel wall, dicyclamine, hyoscyamine, peppermint oil. These are old agents that work to relax that bowel. Ay, cálmate su culo. Relájate su culo. And what happens is that makes it so antispasmodic and relieves the pain. Why do tricyclics work? Because tricyclics are anticholinergic and relax the bowel. That's bad if you got constipation, but it's good if you're contracting too much. Second, tricyclics are analgesics. That's why we can use them for peripheral neuropathy. Third, irritable bowels associated with depression now, isn't it? So you got 3 reasons tricyclics work. Tricyclics work because they're analgesic, they work because they're anticholinergic, and they work because they're antidepressant. Now, here's some specialty things just for irritable bowel syndrome. Rifaximin has some effect. Rifaximin is a non-absorbed antibacterial for traveler's diarrhea. diarrhea and has some effect in slowing down and controlling diarrhea predominant. Alosetron is like having Prozac of your bowel. Okay, so what it does is it alters serotonin. You see, serotonin was discovered in the bowel before as you discovered in the head for your antidepressants. Eloxetoline, the mu opioid receptor, these are also the substances like eloxetoline and other things that inhibit the mus also work for drugs that cause opiate-induced constipation. In other words, somebody's on pain meds for cancer pain and you use these mu opiate receptor antagonists, which relieve the diarrhea, relieve the constipation, but don't affect the analgesic capacity elsewhere in the body. Probiotics is not clear on this. Probiotics have no clear answer for anything, honestly. So the thing is that we want them to work, probiotics. They just don't work for anything. We want them to work, but there's nothing at which they're better than placebo. For constipation, polyethylene glycol, PEG. Polyethylene glycol is what we use for bowel preparation. For instance, you're going to get colonoscopy. We use polyethylene glycol to clean you out and everybody. Lubiprostine activates the chloride channel, which is that basically it's like giving you cholera in a pill. Isn't that nice? So it takes, but it works with the same mechanism as cholera does. And here, when you stimulate cyclic GMP, it stimulates bowel motility. So these are all very three legitimate things for constipation. These to clean you out, and these two things basically increase the activity of your bowel. Inflammatory bowel disease is the only one that causes blood. Inflammatory bowel disease, talking about them together, is Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. Which of them has arthralgias? Crohn's or ulcerative colitis? Which has joint pain? They both have joint pain, Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. Which of them causes blood? Both cause blood. Which cause diarrhea? They both cause diarrhea. They both cause diarrhea. They both cause blood. They both cause arthralgias. They both cause pain. Both. But which gives iritis and uveitis? Both. They both have extra intestinal manifestations in the joint, in the eye, iritis, uveitis, and theoretically could make you blind. But which of them causes erythema nodosum, pyoderma gangrenosum, erythema nodosum? Both. They both cause the same skin manifestations. Ooh, which of these will change with disease activity? The erythema nodosum changes with disease activity. The pyoderma does not. So they both cause blood. They both cause pain. They both cause diarrhea. They both cause joint. They both cause eye. They both cause skin. But which one causes sclerosing cholangitis? ERCP, MRCP, MRCP showing beating of the biliary system, beating, you treat it with ursodeoxycholic acid. Which one causes this liver dysfunction? Both of them. And which one causes colon cancer, Crohn's disease, or ulcerative colitis? Both. Why is this? Because Crohn's disease involves the colon 40% of the time, effectively half. So why do they have the same extra intestinal manifestations? Why do they have the same risk of cancer that you need to screen? Because if you have Crohn's that has involved your colon for 10 years, it is the same risk of cancer as ulcerative colitis that's involved your colon for 10 years. Because it's not whether it's Crohn's or ulcerative colitis, it's whether your colon has been involved. And when to screen for colon cancer is one of the most common three or four questions for inflammatory bowel there is. Now, erythema nodosum will change with disease activity. Pyoderma gangrenosum will not. The two that don't change is pyoderma, a great name, pus in the skin that looks like gangrene, and sclerosing cholangitis. Even if you take the colon out, it doesn't get rid of your sclerosing cholangitis. MRCP, ursodeoxycholic acid, cholestyramine. So then what's the difference? If I just said that they both give blood, they both give eye, they both give skin, they both give joint, they both give colon cancer if they've involved the colon for 8 or 10 years, and you scope every year. The main difference is this, is that the Crohn's disease has transmural lesions. Yeah, the skip lesions, too easy. Okay, it has transmural lesions that cause fistula. Crohn's disease causes perirectal disease. ulcerative colitis, you can be cured by surgery because you can't have colitis if you don't have a colon. You can't cure Crohn's disease but surgery. Crohn's disease does get surgery, not for perianal, but Crohn's disease scars and blocks down the small bowel. So you get Crohn's disease with blockage that needs surgery, but it's not surgery to cure it. Crohn's disease, it's surgery to relieve the complications. And that's why Crohn's disease with frequent obstructions and scarring is one of the reasons for short bowel syndrome, because you kept cutting and cutting and cutting. So what's the difference at the end of the day? Perianal disease and fistulas is one of the biggest difference. You don't obstruct the colon with ulcerative colitis, but Crohn's is a smaller bowel. You can obstruct it. The diagnostic test, endoscopy, is the most accurate test. Crohn's disease, because it can be inside the jejunum, and we don't really have a good scope that reaches in the middle of the jejunum. They have this thing called push enteroscopy, which is shove this long, long 30-foot scope down, but it's not great. So you can use barium in the small bowel for the Crohn's disease, but we have some serologic tests. Turns out that Crohn's and ulcerative colitis have some effect on ANCAs. ANCAs, anti-neutrophil cytoplasmic antibodies. And Crohn's disease has a negative ANCA, but anti-Saccharomyces cerevisiae. That's a long name. So Crohn's is negative for ANCA, Crohn's is negative for ANCA, positive for anti-Saccharomyces, and ulcerative colitis the other way around. Positive for ANCA, negative for, what's that word, Saccharomyces cerevisiae? Saccharin, sweet, myces, fungus. Cerevisiae, cerveza, mi amigo. Saccharomyces cerevisiae is the organism used to ferment beer. Why is Crohn's making a beer in your bowel? You're making bowel beer. I don't know. But you have an antibody against it. It helps tell it apart. Now you might say, why are we using those serologic tests? Can't you just scope them? And the answer is sometimes it's not so clear, and sometimes the Crohn's is in places you can't reach. So acute episodes for both get managed with steroids. Now, what's the difference between budesonide and all the other steroids? Budesonide has first pass effect. Remember that, step one? Well, first pass effect is generally something that's bad. It's generally something that gets rid of the effect of your drug before it can help your body. So first pass effect for something that you want to have a systemic effect is bad. I can't have a systemic effect if a drug is absorbed in my bowel and then gets neutralized by my liver. How can it affect the rest of my body? But if you want to have an effect on your bowel and not affect the rest of your body with all the side effects of steroids, cataracts, bone problems, skin problems, psychosis, cataracts, bone problems, skin problems, then budesonide being neutralized in your liver is good. Now, budesonide, you know that as a systemic, as a pill, is one disease only, inflammatory bowel. We use budesonide, you could use it as a cream. We inhale budesonide for asthma and COPD, so as an inhaler, it's good because it has first pass effect. It's like a topical, like a cream. Now, so that is why this is a special drug just for the inflammatory bowels. Now, the 5-ASA derivatives, the key issue is here is it's not sulfasalazine, it's mesalazine. Sulfasalazine, the problem is the sulfur. Sulfasalazine causes rash. Sulfasalazine causes allergic interstitial nephritis. Sulfasalazine causes hemolysis, rash, rash, renal hemolysis. Mesalamine does the same benefit, more benefit, but without all the sulfa side effects. You keep relapsing every time we take you off steroids and you're not being controlled by mesalamine. Now, there are several forms of mesalamine, whether it's Acicol, Rawasa, Pentasa, that are not our biggest thing here because they're dosing forms. It just has to do with whether they take effect in the colon or whether they have effect of the whole bowel. Pentasa is the whole bowel. Pentasa, 5-pentasa, ASA. So the issue is they're all mesalamine derivatives. Well, when we're relapsing off of steroids, like all autoimmune diseases, what do we do when we want to be able to get you off of steroids? Azathioprine, 6-mercaptopurine, the same as in the vasculitides, azathioprine, polymyositis, get you off of steroids, tacrolimus, sirolimus, pimecrolimus. But specific for inflammatory bowel is azathioprine, 6-mercaptopurine, and also TNF inhibitors, tumor necrosis factor inhibitors. Calcium and vitamin D is for both of them because everybody's malabsorbing. Now, perianal disease for Crohn's disease gets a specific thing of, turns out ciprofloxacin and flagyl, metronidazole, when you combine them together, not only are they good for bacteria, cipro and metronidazole, that's why we use them, great drugs for what? For diverticulitis. But it turns out that cipro and metronidazole have an anti-inflammatory effect that puts your ass back together. Isn't it great? Seals up a perianal fistula because they have an anti-inflammatory effect. Who knew? They do. And that's why the fistulas and the perianal can get better. So fistulas, remember, that's one of the major differences with Crohn's, because it's transmural and fistulas, TNF inhibitors. All right, let's give you an advanced level of play. You have a TNF inhibitor and you're not responsive. You know what you do first? Check the level, therapeutic drug monitoring, and make sure you have the right level of TNF inhibitors. Really? You mean it's like gentamicin or vancomycin levels? Yep. Next. Ooh, advanced level of play. You have the right level, but you're still not having an effect. Hemophilia. You're giving factor 8, and it's not working. Why isn't your factor 8 working in hemophilia? Factor 8 antibodies. Really? TNF inhibitor antibodies? Antibodies against the antibodies? Yep. 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 So surgery, you get obstruction from Crohn's disease, or what happens when you all of your immune modulators are not working? The problem with surgery for fistulas is it tends to, although it may cure ulcerative colitis, it recurs at the site of the surgery, and as you try and chop out pieces of the bowel, you get a short bowel syndrome. So you have to do it sometimes if your immune modulators don't work. And the question will say that. It'll say the person is on mesalamine, they got TNF inhibitors, they got steroids and azathioprine, they got other immunomodulators, and their fistula is still not better. You have to cut it out. So, and then here that it'll recur at the site of the surgery. So when you can't get all these for anything better, you have to switch the immunosuppressives. Surgery for fistulas is when you've tried all the immunosuppressives. There's a type of immunosuppressive. It is a alpha integrin inhibitor. It is related to something called natalizumab, but it's natalizumab without the PML, the progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Natalizumab without the PML is vedolizumab, the alpha integrin inhibitor. It inhibits Peyer's patches. An immunosuppressive that only inhibits the immune system in the small bowel, in Peyer's patches where the lymphocytes are made and programmed in your small bowel? You mean it doesn't affect all? Yeah, it's so cool. Wow. Inflammatory bowel disease treatments. Anti-TNF inhibitors, adalimumab, etanercept, infliximab. They're all essentially biologically, golimumab. And if one doesn't work or you get antibodies to one, you can switch. Now, you switched and it's still not working, get out of the class. Get out of the class. You switched and it's still not working, get out of the class. You switched and it's still not working and you go to Hakuna Matata. Hakuna Matata. So what's your question for you and my poor little step two students is that you're not going to get asked to choose between these as which has better efficacy. Your point is you want to close up that fistula, infliximab for fistula. And if all the TNF inhibitors don't work, get out of the class. First pass effect for budesonide means it's good get an inflammatory bowel, doesn't damage the rest of your body. Short bowel is just what it says. But when it says short bowel, does it mean esophagus, small bowel, colon? Means small bowel. Duodenum, jejunum, ileum. And it's when you've had a lot of surgery and you've removed so much of the surface area that you can't absorb your nutrients. So you malabsorb fats, you can't absorb your vitamins, because you need an intact duodenum to absorb calcium, magnesium, iron, and zinc, divalent cations, and you need surface area and time to absorb the other fats. So you use short-chain fatty acids, so they're absorbed easier, little itty-bitty bites, and the short bowel syndrome is managed mechanically with dietary supplements, or you end up having to use intravenous. And intravenous is hyperalimentation, total parenteral nutrition. And it sucks, but you can run marathons. People have run marathons with hyperalimentation, with total parenteral nutrition, when you've removed so much small bowel that it's essentially like you've developed celiac disease. So what's loperamide? Well, loperamide will slow the bowel. Teduglutide, yeah, that's a wonderful thing to pronounce, teduglutide, helps the small bowel grow. But the reason you use loperamide is that since you have a short bowel, you want to give the bowel more time to absorb things. So it's like, slow down, give me some time. And teduglutide is a GLP agonist. You mean a GLP agonist like what we use for diabetes, like sitagliptin, saxagliptin, linagliptin, alagliptin? Yeah. And it slows bowel motility. So incretins slow bowel motility and increase their growth factors too. The same way we use these in people who have diabetes to slow the bowel and give you more time to absorb. Now, small intestine SIBO, yeah, it actually, small intestine bacterial overgrowth is basically, we know that we have bacteria in the colon. That's expected, right? Everybody's got E. coli in their colon, anaerobes in their colon. It's expected. Do you have bacteria in your duodenum? Nope. Do you have bacteria in your jejunum? No, you're not supposed to. Do you have bacteria in your ileum? No. The same way that the lung is sterile, past the trachea, past the carina, there ain't supposed to be any bacteria in the lung. There ain't supposed to be any bacteria in the small bowel. But if you've lost your ileocecal valve, the bacteria goes backwards from the large bowel into the small bowel, and it causes you to have malabsorptive symptoms by back leaking of bacteria, and it's like bowel pneumonia in a certain way. So you actually aspirate that bowel and get some quantitative cultures. You're not supposed to have bacteria in there, and small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, SIBO. And guess what you're going to treat the bacteria with? Antibiotics. Why rifaximin? Because it's not absorbed. It's a non-absorbed oral antibiotic. Microscopic colitis is a great name. It basically means that you have signs of colitis, you have signs of inflammation. But when you scope someone, it's microscopic, so when you scope them, it looks normal. Hey, how come you're having this chronic watery diarrhea when it looks normal on your scope of your colon? Because it's microscopic. It's microscopic. Only the biopsy shows inflammation. Oh, you're allergic to your own colon. Only the biopsy shows the inflammation. Now, lymphocytes, mastocytes, collagenous, but microscopic colitis is you have signs of inflammation, but not a visual appearance of inflammation. And so you get it better with steroids because it's an autoimmune disease. You're allergic to your ass and it start to look like glass. It's clear and nice upon the scope, but a new biopsy, it's a different story. You got autoimmune buttitis, microscopic colitis. You've just passed the 50% mark in your GI section, and I feel the knowledge flowing into me. Who has gone far, for I would go farther. Who has been bold and true, for I would be the boldest and truest being of the universe. And who shall sing hymns fit for the earth, for I am mad with a devouring ecstasy to sing joyous hymns fit for the whole earth.